Major support for Do the Math has been provided by Chevron, the Kern County Superintendent of Schools, California Resources Corporation, Southern California Edison, Kern Schools Federal Credit Union, Panama Buena Vista Union School District, and the San Luis Obispo County Office of Education. With additional production assistance provided by these supporters of education in Kern County and throughout the state of California.
We are live today at Franklin Elementary School, and we're here to...
Well, good afternoon and welcome to Do the Math. I'm Michael.
And I'm Chuck. If you have math questions, you need help in your homework, you're getting ready for a test, give us a call here in Bakersfield at 636-4357. There's a toll-free number for the outlying areas such as San Luis Obispo. You can call at 1-866-636-6284. You can email us questions if it's easier at dothemath@kern.org. You can watch your show live online at dothemathonline.net. And we're on social media, Facebook and Instagram, Twitter and YouTube.
I figured I'd just hold up that Doc Bernstein's ice cream thing while you were going through that right there.
Saves
a little bit of time.
Yes.
Right. Anyway, we have a full slate of programming to get through today. We have a couple of phone calls waiting. We have a special guest in studio. We'll head back out to Franklin. But first, let's take a look at today's Math in the News. Now, first of all, welcome back.
Oh, thank you.
I mean you just missed a day.
Just took a day off, that's
and,
all.
It was nice that we had Yost come in and fill in for you that afternoon, and Yost had a great time down here.
Oh, good.
I think he's looking forward to doing some more math, so I said, Yost, whenever you're ready, you come on down, and we'll put you right at the end of the table and get busy and do some more math.
That's
so
good.
Anyway, welcome back. And your team is still in the playoff hunt.
Yes, I've got my I got my giant shirt on.
Underneath? Yes, okay, so San Francisco is still in the playoffs. And we're right in the middle of football season. It's underway, and things are kind of settling as far as the standings and stuff like that
yep.
go. So I figured, I was looking through the paper the other day, and I figured, well, let's take a look at one of these, because we usually do box scores
right
at one point during the year. And we usually do baseball box scores, but I figured let's take a look at a football
Because I can't think of a sport with many more numbers and stats than baseball.
Right.
There's a stat for everything.
And every year they make up new ones.
That's
There's
right.
always something new added to baseball every year. But anyway, here's one from this past weekend when Buffalo and the Rams played. And first of all, what they do is they break it down by the score by quarters. And then in each one of the quarters, you can see what happened as far as who scored, the time, the score, and things like that. So then you can keep on going down. So there's all four. And then I figured, all right, the team stats. So then you can see how many first downs, the total net yards, the rushes, the passing, sacks. And there are many more that go into this.
Mm-hmm.
But those are the ones that most people are looking at and the most common
right.
stats that people are looking at. So then it's like, all right, let's go down to the individual ones. And those, once again, you can see, all right, well, I know how the team did, but an individual player, I'd like to see how they did, so they have the stats on that. So I was figuring, all right, that's nice. Who does all of that? So there's
right.
a team of statisticians that take care of all of that work.
Yes.
So I figured let's go ahead and take a look at what a statistician does.
Someone's got to crunch all those numbers and keep track of them and be able to find them and be able to use them.
And manipulate them and things like
exactly.
that. So they use statistical methods to collect and analyze data and help solve real-world problems in business, engineering, the sciences, or other fields such as sports, events.
Which okay. is not a real-world problem, but okay.
That's going on, so we'll count it as one. So then I was like, all right, so that's what they do, and we see some of the numbers that they work with. But what's the important number? Meaning, what do they make?
Right.
All right. So the mean annual salary, so the average for students that aren't familiar with what mean is. And we can see these are for 2015. In the United States, the average was around $84,000. However, based on where you are in the United mm-hmm. States, it will increase. Being Northern California
yes.
is the place to be if you have a nice firm or whatever that you're working for. Also, the federal government, I'm sure, is right in there. Washington, D.C., you can see is, you know, about 20, more than 20,000 more
yeah.
than the national average. So a statistician can make a pretty nice living
mm-hmm.
if what you'd like to do is work with numbers and things like that. So I found one last cartoon, and we can take a look at this right now. So it says, fields arranged by purity. So we've got a sociologist, and a psychologist says, well, sociology is just applied psychology. The biologist, psychology is just applied biology. The chemist, biology is just applied chemistry. The physicist, which is just applied physics, it's nice to be on top. Then the mathematician all the way over on the end. Oh, hey, I didn't see you guys all the way over there.
Yeah.
So that's where the mathematician is. This guy thinking
arranged,
the physicist.
Arranged by purity, I like that.
Right. So there it is, and that is today's Math in the News. 636-4357 is the phone number. We do have phone tutors available until 5:30 on most Tuesdays and Wednesdays throughout the regular school year. And we are here to help you out with your homework. As Chuck said, if you're getting ready for a test, maybe prepping for something coming up.
Maybe you've been absent, you've got makeup work to do.
Right, so there's a lot of different things that we're here to help you out with. We've also got Sean in studio. And Sean, why don't you let everybody know where you go to school and what grade you're in?
Oh, I go to Hart School, and I can't remember.
What grade are you in? You know what grade you're in.
I'm in six.
There you go.
Yeah.
So Hart, home of the Hawks, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And how long have you been at Hart Elementary?
Since I was in kindergarten.
So since you were in kindergarten. So you've been there a long time. You're getting ready mm-hmm. to leave next year. So you're at the top of the food chain, so to speak, at Hart right now.
Yeah.
Have you guys been to Camp Keep yet this year?
No.
Do you know if you're going to Camp Keep?
Yes.
So have you learned anything about that yet, or is it still a ways off in the distance?
We haven't done anything with it.
Okay, so you're probably going in the spring then.
Yeah.
Well, I can tell you one thing. A lot of the students that have been on the program that are older than sixth grade have always said that one of the greatest things about sixth grade was going to Camp Keep. So that's a little something to look forward to, all right?
Yeah.
Okay. 636-4357 is the phone number. We're going to go right to the phones right now. A student from Old River. Samantha, how are you today?
I'm good.
And as soon as you're ready, let's hear that math problem that you're working on.
It's 4n minus 11n equals 105.
So make sure he's got that written on the board correctly, and then I think you guys can start.
I think I caught up with you. 4n minus 11n. Equals 105, is that right?
Yes.
Okay. So it says to solve the equation, right?
Yes.
So what does it mean to solve an equation?
It means to make it so on one side it's an n, and on the other side it's a number.
So when we're all done down here, we should have n equals, and we should have our answer, right?
Yes.
All right, so let's see what we have to do. How do we get n all by itself? What's our first step in this equation?
We have to... So because the 11n is a positive, or I mean a negative, you have to put a positive number to make it so the 11 goes away.
Okay, so we could do that.
N, so you have to add the n together.
Yeah, we can do what you said, but because we have like terms, right, we can mm-hmm. simplify.
You have to add them together.
Yeah, before we even try to solve it, we can try to simplify it. As an example, if we had parentheses in here, or in this case, like terms, we can make it easier. So mm-hmm. let's take 4n minus 11n, and what do we get?
So because 11n is a negative, you have to add 4 to, you have to subtract 4 from 11.
So what's 11 minus 4?
7.
So that's going to be 7n.
Mm-hmm.
Is it going to be positive 7n or negative 7n?
Negative 7n.
Why negative?
Because the 11 is negative, and 11 is bigger than 4. So it has to be a negative.
So the 11 is bigger than 4, so my answer is going to be more negative than it is positive, right? We could think of this as a positive 4n and a negative 11n, mm-hmm. and you get more negatives than positives.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a really good one step to combine like terms. And we haven't done anything with that 105.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so we've got just one term now, but we've got more than just the n.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. We got to get rid of that negative 7. How do we do that?
We add a positive 7.
Well, let's see. Let me ask you, what does that negative 7 end mean? What operation is being done here? Adding, subtracting, multiplying, or dividing?
Subtracting.
Well, it's a 7n. What does 7n mean?
So I think what it means is that you have no 7n's and you owe like 7n.
Right, but when you have a number and a variable next to each other, what operation is that?
Multiplying?
Yes, it is, isn't it? Mm-hmm. So we know that this is negative 7 times n, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So what we have to do to get rid of that negative 7 is undo that multiplication. What's the opposite of multiplication?
Division.
Division. So I'm going to divide, and I'm going to show division as a fraction, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to divide both sides of that equation by?
7.
The number we're trying to get rid of. Not just 7, but negative 7, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So we want to cancel out that multiplication by dividing by that number. But since this is an equation, whatever we do to one side?
We have to do to the other.
Have to do the other. We have to keep the equation balanced, don't we?
Mm-hmm.
All right, so I'll do the easy part. Negative 7 divided by negative 7 is 1,
is 1.
Isn't it? That's 1n, but I don't need to write 1n, do I?
Mm-hmm. You just need to write n.
1n is just 1n, isn't it? And
mm-hmm.
What's 105 divided by negative 7? So it's a pretty easy problem to do in your head or just work it out. What do you get?
So 105 divided by negative 7 is 15.
Pardon?
15.
15, right? Mm-hmm. So that's 15. Is it positive 15 or negative 15?
Negative 15.
And why is it negative?
Because a negative divided by a positive or a negative times a positive is always a negative.
Or in this case, a positive divided by a negative, right? If the signs are different, my answer is negative. So you got to be careful. Up here you said when the bigger number was negative, the answer is negative, right?
Mm-hmm.
But here the bigger number isn't negative, is it? It's only negative 7. But does it matter how big the numbers are? If the signs are different, the answer is negative.
Okay.
That should be our answer. Now, do you have to go back and check your answer?
Yes.
So let's see. What's 4 times negative 15? Minus 11 times negative 15. The question is that 105? Well, let's see. What's 4 times negative 15? What's 4 times 15?
15 times 4 is 60.
60. And that's negative, isn't it?
Yes.
Positive,
so it's
times negative
60.
And what's negative 11 times negative 15?
It has to be a positive.
Yeah, negative times negative is positive. And what's 15 times 11?
I have to add these together.
Yeah, so 1 times 15, 1 times
165.
165.
A positive 165.
So it's positive 165.
Mm-hmm.
So what's 165 minus 60?
105.
Which is exactly what we wanted, so our answer checks out. Okay, thanks for the call.
Nicely done. Samantha, you still online with us?
Yeah.
All right, well, you know what? That was such a great problem. We're going to send you over to Johnny Rocket so you can enjoy a meal. Congratulations on that, and thanks for giving us a phone call. We do have phone tutors available until 5:30. The phone number is 636-4357. Did you know how to do that problem?
Yeah.
Yeah? You ready to do some more like that?
Yeah.
Well, maybe we will. But it's always nice to see things like that, because also if you haven't done a problem like that, I'm sure you'll see it at some point in the future of sixth grade, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right, well, you know what? Speaking of sixth grade and all of the other grades, we're going to head out to Franklin Elementary right now with Marylou.
Thanks, Mike. We're here at Franklin Elementary School, and I'm here with Elena. Hello.
Hi.
How are you doing today?
Good.
Now, what grade are you in?
I'm in fourth grade.
Fourth grade. What is your favorite thing about fourth grade this year?
Well, I'm starting to like the math. I'm understanding it more.
Yeah, but is that your very favorite thing to do? Is there something else?
Yeah, it's my favorite thing to do.
Yeah, what's your second favorite thing to do?
That would be reading.
That's important too, huh? Well, with reading and math, we both have that behind us, don't we? Because we have a math problem that we have to read. Here we go. There are 25 gold paper clips and 75 silver paper clips in each box. How many silver paper clips are in 8 boxes? Well, there's some important information, right, that we need. Mm-hmm. Do we really need the information about the 25 gold paper clips?
No.
No, that's unnecessary information. And sometimes they try to trick you, huh? Mm-hmm. They try to throw in information that you really don't need. We really don't need about the gold. We don't need any information about that. The question is, how many silver paper clips are in the box, right? In 8 boxes, not just one, but in 8, huh? So we know there's 75 in one box, but we need 8 boxes. So Elena, what do we have to do to solve this?
We need to multiply.
We do. So why don't you go ahead and write up our problem, 75 multiplied by 8 up on the board for us. Wow, your 5s are way nicer than mine. And what are you going to multiply first?
I'm going to multiply these two.
Okay.
So, I equals 40.
Very good. And what are we going to do with the 4?
We put it up here.
Okay.
And now we do 8 times 7. That equals 56.
Very good. And what are we going to do with that 4?
We add it a 4. So 56, 57, 58, 59, 60. So.
And are we done?
Mm-mm.
No, why? Why are we not done?
Because we still need the 25.
But that's not, we don't really need that, do we? Because it just wants to know that about silver paper clips, huh? It doesn't really need the 25 paper clips, does it? No, we just want to know how many silver paper clips are in 8 boxes. So looking at our choices here, we have A, 800, B, 640, C, 600, or D, 200. Before we even worked out our problem, Elena, would you guess that D, 200 was way too small? Yeah, I would guess that's way too small, because even estimating 75 in one box and we need 8 boxes, that's almost, if I even estimated that to 100, that's going to be around 800, huh? And that's way too low, isn't it? But we know that it's what? Okay, so go ahead and circle our correct answer. Where is it? It's right there, isn't it?
Yeah.
And there you go. All right. Awesome job today. Reading and math, huh? Great job. All right, Mike, back to you in the studio.
All right. Nicely done with Elaine out there at Franklin Elementary. We do have phone tutors available until 5:30. Don't forget, you can always email us also at dothemath@kern.org, because our students that have emailed us, and today and tomorrow are the best days to email us if you have a problem and you can't get on the phone, something's going on, you're not able to watch the program, email us today and tomorrow. That way we can get back to you tonight or tomorrow.
So you don't have to wait a week to see it on next week's show, right?
Yeah, you get homework on Friday and you're like, oh, let me email it in. We won't be able to get back to you until Wednesday. So hopefully if you need to email us, you can do it on a Tuesday or a Wednesday. Sean, you feel loose, ready to go?
Yeah.
All right, over to the board, young man.
Yay.
Your math homework looks like you are multiplying fractions. So let's go ahead and let's see, let's try this one. 2/5, so 2/5, times 1/9. And as you're doing that, explain to us what you're doing and where you're getting numbers from and the procedure you're going through. All right?
So we're doing, we would have to do the 5 times the 9 and then the 2 times the 1.
So just both numbers on the bottom and
eight.
Both numbers on the
yeah.
top? Okay, so what answer do you get over there?
So with that, you would get 2/45.
And can you reduce 2/45? Because I know they always ask you to simplify fractions, right?
No, we cannot.
And how do you know that?
Because 1 is even, 1 is odd.
Yeah, and nothing goes in about 2 and 45. Cause two, like you said, 2 is even.
Two,
and
would go to 44 or 46, but not 45.
And that's your answer. Great.
All right, nicely done. So that's the warm-up one for you, all right? Yay. So we'll let Chuck erase the board, and we'll get another one ready for you right now. So now it's the whole number 8.
Okay.
Times 3 over 4. So this one's a little different because they're not both fractions right now.
Mm-hmm.
So explain to us what we need to do.
So what we need to do is make this a fraction. And so like that, that would equal 8 over 1 because, you know, there's 8 ones, so 8.
Because we know that a fraction sign means division, right? So 8 divided by 1 is 8, isn't it? Right.
So multiply that by 3/4. 1 times 4 is 4, and 8 times 3 is 24. And then what I would do is simplify.
Yeah, so now there's two parts of this, right? When you say simplify, what are you going to do first?
Make the mixed number.
Okay, so let's make it into a mixed number. Now, how do you know it's a mixed number?
Because the numerator is greater than the denominator.
Right. Top-heavy fraction or improper fraction, right?
Yeah.
So what do you get?
Do this, you would get 6.
So 4 goes into 24
six times
with what left over?
0.
So you don't really get a mixed number for an answer, do you?
No, you get a whole number.
You just get a nice whole number. So our answer is just equals 6. And we're done.
Now, before I let you go, I'd like you, Sean, because there are going to be times when you work with larger numbers. I want you to see if you can simplify before you multiply. So take a look at the problem that you just did.
So you had a choice. When you multiplied, you got 24 over 6, or 24 over 4, and you got 6.
Yeah.
So you reduced here. Mr. Kushon's question is, can you reduce here? Have you ever reduced in the problem before you multiply?
I don't think so.
So here's what you can think. You don't always write this down, but what you can think of is 8 times 3 is just what you do on top, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And 1 times 4 is what you do on the bottom.
Yeah.
So really, when they say multiplying fractions, you multiply the numerator and you multiply the denominator.
Mm-hmm.
But now if I think of this as one big fraction, does anything on the top reduce with anything on the bottom?
Oh, yeah. The
8
and
4. 8 and 4. What goes into both 8 and 4?
4.
So divide them both by 4. What do you get? So cross that out and it becomes
a 2.
And cross that out and it's
a 1.
So now multiply. What do you get on top?
The 1 times 3 is 3.
No. Nope. What is this out?
Oh, 2.
It's a 2. So go ahead and erase that 3.
Yeah. Kind of looks like a 1 to me.
Yeah.
You know, it's my own handwriting. So 2 times 3 is 6.
And on the bottom?
And then 1 times 1 is 1.
And you said the whole number 8 was 8 over 1. But we also know that the fraction 6 over 1 is equal to?
6.
And there's your answer. So, like we were saying, if the numbers are really big, now this wasn't too bad of a problem, but if you had like 24s and 16s and 38s, this could be a really big number when you multiply. So this just makes the problem easier.
Yeah.
Great.
All right, nicely done. And a perfect example of why it's important to write your numerals clearly so that you know exactly what it is. All right, come on back over here, Sean. 636-4357 is the phone number. We do have phone tutors available until 5:30. Right now, we're going to head up the hill to Tehachapi Jacobson Middle School. Julio, how are you today?
Good.
What grade are you in?
6th grade.
All right, as soon as you're ready, let's hear the math problem you're working on.
Which group contains radios that are all equivalent to 4 to 36?
I'm sorry.
All right, so we're looking for ratios.
So
that are equivalent to 4 to 36.
So is it written 4 to 36 like this, Jacob?
It's 4.
And the two dots?
Yeah.
There you go.
So 4 to 36, that's another. So there's your ratio, right? And so we want to compare some other ratios to this?
Yeah.
Okay, so what other information are you given in the problem?
It just gives me that are all equivalent.
So what options do they give you? Do they give you some options to look at?
Yeah, they give me 1 to 9, 2 to 10, 3 to 11, 9 to 1, 18 to 2, 27 to 3, 1 to 9, 2 to 27, and 2 to 36, 1 to 9, 2 to 18, and 3 to 27.
All right, here's what we're going to do. You had a lot of stuff right there. So Chuck, erase those. I've got them written down here in a different thing, so it might make a little more sense.
Okay. So let's see if we can get rid of this. No.
You got rid of it, all right. You moved it.
I sure did, didn't I? Here, I can do this.
There you go. All right, so we're going to have four options, A, B, C, and D. Each one of those options will have three parts to it.
Oh, okay.
So A is 1 to 9.
1 to 9.
As well as 2 to 10.
2 to 10.
And 3 to 11.
3 to 11.
Option B is 9 to 1, 18 to 2, and 27 to 3.
27 to 3.
Part C, 1 to 9, 2 to 27, 3 to 36. Part D, 1 to 9, 2 to 18, and finally 3 to 27. Julio, take a look at the board and see if those are all written up there accurately and those are the ones that you're working with.
Okay, hold on.
Okay. And that's a two.
So you ready to go, Julio?
Yeah.
Okay, so Julio, we want to compare this to one of those lists, right? So we're hoping that all of these should be the same. So let's go ahead and go back to the problem that you're given, right? So
yeah.
4 to 36. Can you simplify or reduce 4 to 36?
Yeah.
What's that reduced down to? What's that the same as?
Actually, you can simplify it by 9.
By 9, right? So 4 to 36, do you write ratios as fractions also?
Yeah.
So we can write that as 4 to 36, right?
Yeah.
And you said 9, so 4 goes in the 4 one time, and 4 goes in the 36 9 times, is that right?
Yeah.
So if we were going to put it in the same form, we would write this 1 to 9, correct? So it looks like the ratio that they gave you is 1 to 9. So here, let's go look at our choices. So we know it can't be B, right? Because that's 9 to 1. So this is 1 to 9. Is 2 to 10 the same as 1 to 9? What's 2 to 10 reduced to?
2 to 10 is reduced to 5?
5, right? So it's going to be 1 to 5, isn't it? Which is not the same, right? 1 to 9 and 1 to 5 are different, so that's not going to work either, is it?
No.
How about C? We have 1 to 9, which is what we wanted. Does 2 to 27 reduce to 1 to 9? Can you simplify 2 to 27? Two goes into 2 once, but 2 doesn't go into 27, does it?
No.
So that doesn't work. So C doesn't work. So I hope it's D, right?
Yeah.
Let's see. 1 to 9? Yep. That's what we needed. How about 2 to 18?
Yeah.
Divide by 2. Divide by 2, right? How about 3 to 27?
3 times 9.
So 3 divided by 3 is 1, and 27 divided by 3 is 9. They all give me the same ratio of 1 to 9, don't they? So it looks like your answer to this problem is D. Those all reduce down to the same ratio that you started with. Okay?
Hooray!
Thanks for the call.
All right, nicely done. Do remember, Julio, we have phone tutors available until 5:30. We'll be back with more right after this. Today we're at Scenic Fraser Park, home of El Cajon School, and today we're here to
cheer them on!
Once again, again, we're at El Tajon School. I've got eighth grade student Giggles with me here. Sarah, how are you today?
Good.
All right, you gonna be able to do this problem?
I hope so.
All right, here we go. Let's go ahead and turn around. All right, go ahead and put the number 30 up there. Do you know what a factor is? A factor of a number. What's a factor?
The numbers that will multiply to make 30.
Okay, numbers that will go into 30 evenly, right? How many positive factors does 30 have? So how would you figure that out? We want to know how many factors 30 has.
Four.
So
there's 1 and 30.
Okay.
And then 2 and 15. And then 5 and 6.
Anything else going to 30?
No.
All right, so you went from 1 to 2, because you know 1 will go into anything. Multiplied by itself. Then you know 2. How did you know 2 went into 30?
It's an even number.
It's an even number. And you know 2 times 15 will be that. How did you jump to 5 then?
Oh, I missed one.
You missed one? What did you miss?
3 and 10.
Oh, okay. So now how many factors does it have?
8.
All right, so the first time you had 6, now you've got 8. Are you sure you're going to stick with 8?
Yeah.
Positive. You don't get to change it again. You set?
Yeah.
All right. So we know the 1 times 30, 2 times 15, the one that you missed but you realized was 3, 3 times 10, but then you went to 5. What's the matter with 4?
It doesn't go into it evenly.
It doesn't go into it evenly, right? So you know to skip that, and by knowing your multiplication facts, you know that. So then you go to 5, and then you went to 6. Right, because 5 times 6. How do you know to stop then?
Because 7 doesn't go into it. Neither does 8.
Okay.
Or 9. And then you already have 10.
Okay. But why don't we do all the other ones? So I'm trying to see if you know that. I mean, you realized it. But I want to see if you understand how you knew to stop then.
Okay. Nothing else goes into it evenly.
Right. See, the 5 and the 6 are right next to each other, right?
Yeah.
So once you go 5 and then 6, right, and these are each other, you know you're done. That's how you can tell, because sometimes you'll have a large number that you have to do this with, and when you get the numbers right next to each other like that, you know you're all set, as long as you have all these other ones in there, all right? Mm-hmm. So you first of all had 6, but then you realized that it really 8. Sarah, nicely done. Easy enough problem, wasn't it?
Yep.
Okay. We're at El Tajon School, 8th grade student Story is with me, and we're about to work on some triangles.
Okay.
You ready?
Yes.
Finally we can get to this. All right. So there are 3 main types of triangles. We have an equilateral triangle. What can you tell me about that?
It has all equal size, all equal sides.
Okay. Why don't you just go ahead, and it doesn't have to be perfect, but draw me an equilateral triangle.
Okay.
Good. So by putting those marks in there, you're identifying that all of the angles are the same, okay? But we could even go pretty far on this. What's the measure of each of those?
It depends on how big the triangle is.
Well, how many how many degrees are going to be in a triangle?
360, right?
That's in a quadrilateral. So in a triangle, we're going to have 180.
Okay.
All right. But we're not going to deal with that. So we have an equilateral triangle, all right?
All right?
What is another type of triangle?
Isosceles.
And tell me about an isosceles.
Has 2 equal sides, but
right.
One of them isn't.
Right. So let's say you have 2 longer sides and one's very short at the bottom or whatever. So go ahead and draw me out an isosceles. There you go. Nicely done. So obviously not all the same.
Yeah.
And what is the other one? There's a third type of triangle. A scalene.
Scalene.
There you go. Scalene. What's the deal with a scalene?
It has no equal.
So, go ahead and try your hand at that one.
No.
There you go. You're just showing that one up. There you go.
I won't do that.
All right.
Because that looks like it'll work.
That'll work. So, we're going to work with the isosceles one.
Okay.
All right. So, 2 of the sides measure 15 centimeters, and the other is 10 centimeters.
15. Do you want me to write that bigger?
Well,
is that okay?
No. How do you know that the 2 are 15 and not 2 or 10?
Oh.
Okay, so you're doing the
angle. Wait, didn't you say 2?
Well, here are the two measurements.
Okay.
One side, all right, one side is going to be 15 centimeters. That's the length of one side.
Okay.
The other side is 10 centimeters, all right?
Okay.
So we have two of the three sides. The question is, what is the maximum length perimeter of the triangle?
Okay.
What can the maximum be?
Okay.
So you can make one 15 and one 10. So how would you like to label those? So which one would you like to, if you're looking for the maximum?
The maximum, you would have the two bigger 15.
Okay, so where would you put the 15?
The 15 on the side.
And the 10 would go. So then what would the maximum be?
The maximum would be...
The perimeter would be...
40.
Right, it would be 40.
Yeah,
right?
40
so
centimeters.
The maximum would be 40 centimeters. All right, and that's the answer. That's what I was looking for.
Okay.
If you wanted to do it differently, if I said what was the lowest it could be, how would you label it then?
I'll just do that.
And then what would
and
it be?
Be 35 centimeters.
There you go.
All right.
Nicely done. Not that bad, was it?
Nope.
All right. No need to get nervous. And once again, a big thanks to all the students at El Tejon. We had a great time up there. All of the students were great to work with, and thanks also to the staff. Made it most welcoming for us up there. We do have phone tutors available until 5:30. Right now, we'll go back out live to Franklin Elementary and Mary Lou.
Thanks, Mike. We are back here live at Franklin Elementary School, and I'm with Diana.
Hi.
Hello. What grade are you in?
Fifth grade.
And what is your favorite thing?
My favorite thing is math, and I love to draw.
Yay! That's important, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay. Well, we got some math behind us, don't we?
Yes.
All right. Let's take care of it. We got a lot of numbers, and it's dividing, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Now, before you learn to divide, there's an important step, and what is that?
That you have to know which numbers go into each. Like, for example, if you're going to do 15 and 3, you have to know which goes into 15, so it would be 5, because 3 times 5 is 15.
Very good. So division is just backwards from multiplication.
Yes.
Very good. But another important thing when we get to really big numbers, because the example you gave us, small numbers, right?
Yes.
But now we get into big numbers, triple, double digit, and triple, right? So to help us, we need to use estimation, right? Okay, so if I have a problem like this, I have 304 divided by 18. To help me out, I can first estimate it. So if I'm estimating 300 to the nearest hundreds, Diana, what would that be?
That would be 800.
And if I want to estimate 18 to the nearest tens to help me divide this, what would I estimate that to? Now that would round up, right?
Yes.
And that one rounded?
Down.
Okay, when do we know when to round up and when to round down?
When you know when to round up and when to round down is if there's a bigger number, then you have to change that little number into the biggest, into the second number.
And if it's anything a 5 or up, right?
Yes.
Above 5.
Yes.
And if it's anything below 5, then we
keep it together.
Very good. Okay, so now we can look at this and we could quickly divide. We could think of this as actually, if we think of it, 2 goes into 30 about, what do you think? So we could use estimation kind of help us out, right?
Yes.
So 20 goes into 30 how many times?
One time,
right?
Yes.
And then we would have about 10 left over, right?
Yes.
So then we know that
we need to cross out the zeros, and then how many zeros we cross out, and if we have one left over, we put the zero inside.
There you go. So it's 10.
10.
Awesome. Better than me. Let's do this one up here.
Okay.
Talk us through it.
Okay. So if you have 512, you'd have to run and turn it into 500 and then put our division sign. And then, since it's a low number, we do not change it at all. So we bring this down and it would be 50.
Oh, you're fine.
So it would be 50, and then we would have to cross out the zeros, and then we would have 10, because 5 times 1 equals 5, because it is multiplying the same number.
Very good. Our last one. Now this one is a little different. Here we had our division sign, but here we have the house, right? The division symbol.
Yes.
Okay. Inside is our dividend, which is our first number, correct?
Yes.
And outside is our divisor, which is our second number. How can I rewrite this with estimation?
Well, usually I would round it some. Well,
what could we round this to?
To the nearest 10.
Okay. To the nearest 10, or can we round it using hundreds?
Yes.
What can you round that to?
We could round it into...
Would it round to 400 or 500?
500.
Okay, there you go. Because of the 5, right?
Yes.
We got to round up.
Yes, we do.
Okay. And our 31's going to round to?
30.
Okay. And work your magic there.
Okay, so, and then I think 3 goes into 5 one time.
Well, let's think about it this way. 30 goes into 50, what? Does it go one time? Yeah, let's put the 1 there, okay?
Okay.
Because we know 1 times 30 is just?
1.
It's 30, right?
Yeah.
What's left over? Bring down that. Then we can keep on from there, huh?
Yes.
All right. Good job. But estimating is important. It gets us to where we need, right?
Yes.
Good job today, Diana. All right, Mike, back to you at the studio.
All right, Diana doing some division and some divisibility, which leads us into our next phone call right now. We'll go out. We've got a 6th grade student from Reagan Elementary. Aditya, how are you today?
I'm good.
Why don't you go ahead and read the math problem so that everybody is aware of what you need to do, and then we'll have Chuck help you out with it.
Okay. So my question is, find a number less than 500 that's a multiple of 11, but when it's divided by 4, 6, 8, and 10, it leaves a remainder of 3.
With remainder of 10. Okay, so find a number, you said less than 500?
Yes.
Let me see if I can get this back up here. I guess not. So let me get this. It's not going to move. So find a number less than 500. It's a multiple of 11?
Yes.
And when it's divided by 4, 6, 8, or 10, it has a remainder of 3, right?
Yes.
All right, so I guess one way we can do this problem is we can list all of the multiples of 11, right?
Yeah.
But there's a lot of them. There's a lot of multiples of 11 less than 500. So let's go to these divisions, right? If you divide by 4, they want a remainder of 3, right?
Yes.
And you divide by 6, and you divide by 8, and divide by 10. So do you know where you would start in this problem?
Wait, what?
Where would you start in this problem?
I would start by trying to find, I don't know.
Well, let's start with multiples of 11, right?
Yeah.
But here's the clue. And this is the easiest number to divide by, isn't it? Dividing by 10?
Yeah.
So if I divide a number by 10 and I get a remainder of 3, I know that number has to end with 3, don't I? Doesn't it? So I know that the number that I'm looking for has to end in a 3, doesn't it?
Yes.
So let's look at multiples of 11 that end in 3. Right?
Okay.
So I'm going to start with 11, but I don't want 22, do I?
No.
Because that doesn't end in a 3, but how about 33?
Yes.
Isn't that 3 times 11?
Yeah.
Now, 4 times 11 is not going to work, and 5, nothing else is going to work. What's the next multiple of 11 that ends in a 3? Isn't it going to be 11 times 13?
Yeah, 143.
143, yeah. Right? And the next multiple of 11 and ends in 3 is going to be times 23.
Wait, isn't it going to be
253? I'm sorry, 63, did you say?
253.
253?
Yeah.
Okay. And then times 33, because that's the next number that ends in 3. What's 11 times 33?
363.
That's still under 500. So let's go times 43. What's that?
473.
All right, so I know that these are all multiples of 11. And I know that when I divide by 10, I get a remainder of 3. How about if I divide by 4?
By 4.
Do I get a remainder of 3? So let's see. If I divide this by 4, do I get a remainder of 3? I don't, do
no.
I?
No.
So this doesn't work. If I divide this by 4, do I get a remainder of 3?
No.
No?
No.
No. So that doesn't work. If I divide this by 4, do I get a remainder of 3? Again, it's pretty easy, right? Either use a calculator or just take 253 and divide by 4. Did you get something? Doesn't work, does it?
No.
Nope, that's going to be, that's going to be a 3. That's going to be a remainder of 1, so that doesn't work. And notice I haven't even worked with the 6 and the 8, have I? How about 363?
400.
Does 4 go into
363?
Very nicely. Yes, it goes in there 90 times, doesn't it?
No. It's 90 remainder 3.
Yeah, and there's my remainder 3. So this one works for 4. Does it work with 6?
Yes.
Yes, because 6 goes into 36. Does it work with 8?
Yes.
It turns out that it's 45 remainder 3, doesn't it? And we already know it works with 10. And so I'm going to guess that this is my answer, because 473 I don't think is going to work for many of or any of those. So it looks like 363 is going to be our answer.
Okay.
And again, what we did was we didn't look at all of the multiples of 11, just the ones that ended in 3.
Okay. Right?
Great question. Thanks for calling.
Yeah, nicely done. Great problem right there. All right, erase the board. Sean, back to work with you, young man. So we've done multiplied fractions. We've multiplied a fraction by a whole number. Mm-hmm. Now let's do some mixed numbers, multiplying those. All right, okay. So we've got 1 and 2 fifths. We're going to multiply that by 4 and 2 sevenths. So explain to us how you would approach that problem.
How I would approach this, I would do 7 times 4, which is 28, and then add it by the 2, which is 30.
So let's write that down here. So what are you going to write 4 and 2 sevenths as?
So I would write as 7 on the bottom, because the same denominator. And then since what I did in 30, 30 would be the numerator.
So one of the other problems we did, you had a mixed number. I mean, you had an improper fraction, and you changed it to a mixed number. Mm-hmm. For your answer, and now in this one you change from a mixed number to an improper fraction.
Yes.
Because we know we want to multiply two fractions together, mm-hmm. Right? So how about the 1 and 2 fifths?
1 and 2 fifths, again, the denominator times the whole number, 5, then add what you get there to the numerator, to be 7, right?
Yep.
So 7 over 5.
Mm-hmm. All right, so now you get two fractions to multiply by, right?
Yeah.
Now, here's your choice that we had before, right? You can multiply 7 times 30, and you can multiply 5 times 7, and you get two pretty big numbers, right?
Mm-hmm.
210 and 35. But can you do any reducing before you multiply?
Yes.
What's just jumping right out at you?
Sevens.
Sevens. You can divide both of those by 7, can't you?
So, this would be 1. This would be 1.
Okay. Now, can you do any more reducing?
Yes.
What?
You can do the 5 and the 30.
What goes into both 5 and 30?
5.
5, so divide, what do you get?
This would be 1, and this would be 6.
Wow, isn't that nice? Because what do you get when you multiply the top?
You get 6.
And what do you get when you multiply the bottom?
1.
So write that down, 6/1, because there's our fraction answer, right?
Mm-hmm.
6/1. But we wouldn't leave it that way. What's your answer?
It would be 6.
6, and so your answer should be the whole number 6.
Yeah.
So you multiply two mixed numbers together, and you got a nice whole number answer of 6. Mm-hmm. And there's the problem.
All right, nicely done. 6, the number of the day. Seems like he had that class answer right there. All right, we do have phone tutors available until 5:30 on most Tuesdays and Wednesdays. Right now, we're going to go back to the phones. A student from Rosedale Middle School. Morgan, how are you today?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm wonderful. Are you in 6th, 7th, 8th grade? What grade?
I'm in 7th grade.
All right. As soon as you're ready, let's hear the math problem that you're working on.
All right. The problem is 2 is greater than 8 minus 4/3 h.
All right, so this is an inequality. You want to solve for h, don't you?
Yes.
So now we've got to get rid of everything on this side except the h. Now, depending on your teacher or your book, do you want to end up with h on the left side or the right side? Does it matter?
Let's do the left side.
Okay, it's starting over here, but we'd like it over on this side, right? So we like h is greater than or h is less than something, right?
Right.
All right, so you want to do that now? How do you get that h over on the other side?
Okay.
Or do you want to work with the numbers first?
Hang on. Could you say that again?
So do you want to work with the numbers first or the h first?
You want to work with the numbers first.
Okay, so let's get rid of that 8. Let's leave that alone for right now, and let's get rid of that 8. How do you do that?
You subtract 8 from both sides.
Yeah, because we know that's a positive 8, so I'm going to subtract. And just like in an equation, in an inequality, you got to do the same thing to both sides, don't you?
Yeah.
So I'll do the easy part. 8 minus 8 is 0. Now, I'm going to keep it in the same direction, aren't I?
Yes.
Because subtraction doesn't change the direction, does it? So
no.
This side is negative 4/3 h. What do we get on this side? 2 minus 8.
Negative 4/3 h on the right side.
And what do we have on the left side? 2 minus 8 is?
Negative 6.
Negative 6. All right. So we still got the h here. So let's just leave it here. Let's get rid of that negative 4/3. That's being multiplied, isn't it? How do you get rid of multiplication?
You divide.
You divide. So we're going to divide by the number in front of h, which is negative 4/3. Now, divide. I could divide by negative 4/3, but what's dividing by a fraction the same as?
Multiplying
by the reciprocal. So let's multiply by the reciprocal of 4/3. What's the reciprocal of negative 4/3?
Negative
3/4. Okay? So we're going to multiply by negative 3/4 here. Now, here's where we got to be careful. We just multiply both sides by a negative number, right?
Yeah.
So that means I'm going to change the direction. That's important that we do it right now, right?
Yes.
All right, because I know that negative 4/3 times negative 3/4, everything cancels out, doesn't it? Even mm-hmm. the negatives, and so I get 1 h here. What's negative 3/4 times negative 6?
That would be nine over two, which equals.
Okay, how did you get 9/2?
Okay.
How did you get 9/2?
I got 9/2. I cross canceled the 6 and the 4.
So you reduce the 6 and 4. 2 goes in both of them, right?
Yeah.
Negative times negative is positive. That's 9/2, right?
Yeah.
So 9/2 is less than h. Now, if you wanted to put the h on the other side, I could say h is greater than 9/2, couldn't I?
Yes.
Can you leave your answer as 9/2?
No, you have to simplify.
So h is greater than, what's 9/2?
9/2 is, that would be 4.5.
4.5.
There you go, nicely
and
done right there. And
okay,
for such a great problem, we're going to send you to the movies, courtesy of our friends at Maya Cinema. So congratulations on that. 636-4357 is the phone number. We do have phone tutors available until 5:30. We'll go out one more time to Franklin Elementary and Mary Lou.
Thanks, Mike. We are back here at Franklin Elementary School, and I'm with Samuel.
Hello.
Hello.
And what grade are you in?
Six.
Okay, Samuel, we got a problem behind us, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so a bookstore was selling six books for $31.38. Online, you could buy three books for $16.02. Which place has a lower unit price? So we got to compare, right?
Uh-huh.
Okay, we're going to make a race out of this. You ready? Which one would you like to figure out?
Online.
The online, the three books?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let's go ahead. Then I'm going to figure out the other. So let's go ahead and write our problem out. So I have the $31.38, six books. And you have the three books for $16.02. Ready, set, go. Tell us what you're doing.
I'm going to divide 3 by 16. So if I do 3 times 5, 3 times 5 is 15. So 15 is equal to 16. And I'll get 1 out of 16 minus 15. And then I add the 0 down. And since 10 is not a compatible number with 3, I have to do a number lower than it. So I'm going to do 3, because 3 times 3 is 9. And 10 minus 9 is 1. And putting down the 2 as well. And times 4, because 3 times 4 is 12. And that is my answer.
Okay, and over here, I'm at the end one, and 6 goes into 18, I know 3 times. So Samuel, looking at these, you have $5.34 per book, and I have $5.23 per book. Which would you say is the better buy?
I would say the bookstore.
The bookstore, yeah, $5, because it's a lower price, isn't it? Yeah, and again, we had a lot of dividing to do, huh? Great job today. And Mike, back to you at the studio. It's been a blast here at Franklin today.
All right. You know what? We always enjoy the students over at Franklin Elementary, and a great job by all of those students out there. Do remember, we have phone tutors available until 5:30 over in San Luis Obispo County. That phone number is toll free at 1-866-636-6284. Don't forget, all the girls, they've got things going on Twitter, YouTube, Facebook, mm-hmm. all the different things, and you can always go check them out. Sean, as we do every day, somebody's going to see the condor. So why don't you put your hand in there and find out who's going.
And it is Elena.
Elena, the fourth grade student from Franklin Elementary. Congratulations, Elena, going to see the condors. All right, until we meet again, continue to do the math.
Support for Do the Math has been provided by Chevron, the Kern County Superintendent of Schools, California Resources Corporation, Southern California Edison, Kern Schools Federal Credit Union, Panama Buena Vista Union School District, and the San Luis Obispo County Office of Education. With additional production assistance provided by the supporters of education in Kern County and throughout the state of California.